Hello, I'm Tom Hoving.
Hello.
How are you? Good to see you, kiddo.
The artful Tommy, that's me.
A critic last week said that the two represent, respectively, the best and the worst of Tom Hoving. What do you think of that assessment?
I think it's rather silly.
In what way?
Well, who is it? Who said it? Who was the critic?
Who was the critic?
Yeah.
I was.
Even sillier.
What you should do in working an art museum. First, go directly to the postcard stand. Yes, the postcard stand, because there they have on display every one of the great treasures in their institution, the most popular things. And if you're in a country that speaks no language known to you, you can buy the things and you can show it to one of the guards and say, how do I get to it?
In what way is this museum unique? How does it differ from other museums?
It really is the only institution, not only in America, but in the world, for very curious reasons, that is a balanced encyclopedia of all of the visual aspects of man's creativity.
Now, what kind of equipment do you need? Well, there's a certain type of thing. Every activity has its own equipment. For me, indispensable pair of sneakers.
First time I ever went to Egypt in Cairo, and I was there to organize the King Tut show. So I arrived, and I was picked up in huge limousine, and I was swept into the city. And a city that was just a gaggle of chaos, of sounds, of people hanging onto the sides of buses, and nothing working, and just thousands and thousands of people. And I loved it. And about halfway through, I said, can I get out of this car? I mean, is there another way to go? And they were terribly shocked. And I said, I'd just like to walk. And I walked to Tahrir Square, where every bus in all of Egypt comes, right? Every road leads to this, right? And I got out, and I smelled the diesel fumes, and people are speaking Arabic, and they're chanting, and they're walking in galabiyas. I'm going crazy. And then I go right into the Egyptian Museum. At this point, nobody knows who I am. I haven't been met by the officials and all of this. And I walk into the galleries, and there is ramshackle city of museums. And up there in the King Tut galleries, I am face to face for the first time, 2,500-year-old things that look like they were made yesterday. And I know that they're all mine.
A light, very, very important. A little one of these, particularly in the Cairo Museum. A bigger one for the Cairo Museum.
When I was organizing the Tut show, and we got a empty gallery in the Cairo Museum and brought in photographers, black paper, and made a photography studio, and we were the only ones up to that point allowed to take things out of the cases. The first 4 days we had 17 curators and lead seals and logs and guys, armed guards, you know, and we had to go to every case and open it up and be logged in the exact moment and all that. 4 days, there was nobody near. Hey, I need some help to open a case. That's your problem. The guards were sleeping on pallets in our photography studio. All we had was the coffee schlepper, and I enlisted him to help me move the stuff. I had to take the glass case off King Tut's mask and put some boards down so I wouldn't crash through the other vitrines, and I got this thing off, and I got this thing. I put my hands on it, and I went, eh? And it's heavy, because this is gold, 1/4 inch. And I got it down, I'm beginning to sweat profusely, it's hot. Get it down on the ground, the schlepper's looking at me. And I look around, nobody's around, I went,
Elitist, stodgy, dead. Just a few of the adjectives once used to describe New York City's Metropolitan Museum of Art. But that was before Thomas Hoving took over as director in 1967.
There are skates, roller skates, for places like the Temple of Dendur, which is large enough to do it. And
the operative philosophy was art for the masses, or art for more people than the elite.
We went back to the founders, two purposes of 1870. The people who started the Met had two goals. One, popular instruction, which meant broad instruction, and recreation. That wasn't bouncing basketballs. It was recreation, refreshment of the mind and the eye and the soul. We went back to what they wanted and opened the place up.
We caused a revolution
There were board members who were part of the revolution. There were staff who were part of the revolution. I didn't do it all, but I got all the blame.
I like to take these binoculars. These allow you to look inside a case and bring the things in the back of that case much more close to you. Also, people gather around you. They think you're a real pro.
We made an exciting place to come to. Now, as a kid, I courted my wife, we're now married 40 years, at the Museum of Modern Art. And you took your dates to the Museum of Modern Art.
What created the most controversy for you at the Met?
Everything.
I know, it did.
My goal was to have young people to take their dates to my museum, the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And that's why the beautiful steps in front of it, those great steps were done not just to have an imposing entrance to the place, but also someplace where people could gather and sit there. Lovely sunny afternoon, get to know each other and maybe come in and take a look at the art.
There's that infamous New Yorker cartoon
right.
that has Welcome Mr. Hoving, making fun of the banners and the ways that you tried to jazz up the place. Why do you think people were a little bit opposed to that cartoon?
Was the thing that the week I became director, that cartoon appeared in the New Yorker. When I saw it, I said, banners, we ought to have banners.
So you got the idea from the cartoon.
I got the idea from the cartoon. So.
You take no prisoners.
None, not even myself.
Should any government agency have any say in what art it finances?
Well, I think essentially government and art are totally incompatible. Congress is in the business of compromise. They're in the business of homogenizing things. They're in the business of supposedly of making legislation.
First of all, it's so intellectually specious, it's embarrassing for me to sit and listen to it.
Cannot censor in a free society, which the United States is. Now, this congressman and others and senators would try to change the freedom of the United States, thinking that they are nearer, my God,
in
to
other
anybody
words, when
else.
You, when you have an NEA,
any
you...
tiny chip away takes away the freedom that we have fought for a lot of years.
I do not approve of censorship in any form, and this is not censorship.
Mr. Army here would have gone back and have censored Tom Paine.
There
he would censor
again.
Anything
well,
he wants
know
to
what
say.
I would have
free
done.
Creativity.
Well, you know what I would have done. You've known me for 10 minutes.
Off the camera, this fellow said it's the leftist liberals, and that's a trigger. This is just another political ideologue. And this bozo, and the other people who are censored, I call people who tried to topple the freedoms of the United States a bozo, a clown. Every censor in the history of the business has always prefaced everything by saying, I do not believe in censorship. I believe, however, in the will of the people.
Say, accountability to whom? To the elected representatives of the people.
The elected representatives are going to say what is a work of art or not?
No, yeah, we're going to say...
What do you know about
it? If I walk into your shop and you have a... The vast majority of the American public of every religious persuasion.
Now, you know this? You phoned them all? Millions, 260 million?
How do we know this?
How do you know this?
The search for great art. Explain it to me. Tell me your best story that illustrates this process, this game, the thing that most ignited the full power, curiosity, energy of Tom Hoving.
It did.
Yes, it did.
Great treasures come from nowhere.
Yeah.
A Velasquez.
Yes.
Juan de Pereja, 1650, perfect condition, English country house, Lord Radnor, never was going to sell it. It came up on the market. We had to have the painting. We had been after it. Where were we going to get the money? What were we going to do about the competition? So, the money we raised.
Yeah, but you raised it by selling some of your own collection.
Actually, no. We raised the money and then later had to sell things to help pay back for the loan that we had taken from our own endowment.
And Parks Commissioner, a great photograph of you bicycling through the park was kind of a notion of the Lindsay administration. A young group of people had taken over running this city.
And I, as swinging Parks Commissioner of the City of New York, Clown Prince of Fun City.
Here are the Beatles!
And I went to Munich to examine it. The rumors of its beauty had done it no justice. It was far finer than had been reported.
How would an unscrupulous person take a 500-pound bronze and get it out of Italy? It's a question of organization.
It's not only a library, a documentation center. It's literally a feast. People come here to devour the material.
Tom Hoving has a report on the way they were and the way they are now.
Jaws 2.
The question is, will people really go back?
In this case, if it's a success,
would you be interested in continuing the role of Martin Brody?
How would you characterize your style of singing?
Very unusual.
Today is opening day for the general public. The show is completely sold out.
I still don't know how you do that.
I have no time to use.
Oh, don't do that.
Get it again.
That was the question.
Now, I've heard that portrait painters are really trying to flagellate, eviscerate, deracinate, cut themselves in the tiny little pieces of glass, and all that sort of stuff. Is that true?
Oops.
Shit. What goes on in this particular area? Why are we wearing silver suits?
Oops.
People who collect art are a little bit crazy, right? Even if they're professional curators in a museum, you're a little kind of nuts about it. You know, you there's a passion.
One afternoon, sitting outside, beautiful day, I wrote a list, walked through my entire life of art, walked through it double time, and wrote down on a piece of paper what had totally wiped me out. I mean, things that I didn't know who had done them, when, I didn't care when they had been done, but I saw them in my travels around Europe, and these things, and the United States, and they just riveted me. Inside these works of art, there's a force that transcends language, anything.
Now, if I had been a night watchman at the Metropolitan Museum of Art for 10 years, instead of a curator and director for 18 and a half, then you might say that my expertise is not so good. My expertise is very good.
Hey, Laurent. Trim. Fuel. Now the engine.
It's always nice to drive down the Hudson River toward the city in an airplane. There's a George Washington Bridge. For visual travel, it's one of the most exciting trips anywhere in the world. Statue of Liberty looking very good. World Trade Center. All of Manhattan Lane. There's Central Park. And we've been cleared to land in the Great Meadow.
Is that you, Larry?
Yes, sir.
Tommy.
Yes, sir. How are you?
Art. Is it real?
A real work of art changes your blood pressure, makes you think, makes you laugh, or makes you frown, brings back all reminiscences of many things in your life.
Or is it fake?
A forgery is dead on arrival. It speaks nothing, it says nothing. Worse than fraud, it's death on arrival. It's not life, which is works of art, is life.
Is it good?
A riveting self-portrait, as good as any late Rembrandt. Do not miss it.
If it's gorgeous, it's just full of life.
It's that good.
Which ones do I like? All of them.
On fire.
Or is it bad?
Frankly, wild horses couldn't drag me to this place, particularly in the old days. The shows were kind of...
Screw you to the Grim Reaper.
Art forgery is as old as mankind. And it will last as long as humanity lasts.
Which is the real Tom Hoving?
And who will speak?